So let's now, in the remaining time, what I want to do is want to go through some of these other topics, in particular RC circuits, because I've seen that there is a lot of confusion about RC circuits in students. Some students, when they come for our MTech interviews, for example, they are not quite clear about how to handle an RC circuit or RL circuit. So important. So I thought I'll just share some of these slides with you. Yeah, so in the meanwhile, I should just say something about these RC circuits. Simple things like why is the capacitor voltage, why does it not change instantaneously? Okay, things like this I've asked in at several places, which I visited when I gave talks on circuit simulation and so on. And I've not really got satisfactory answers most of the times. So that is why I thought it is important to just clarify some of these issues, so that when you teach, you should explicitly point out why that happens. I've asked whether, what exactly will happen if the capacitor voltage changed suddenly, and very often I did not get a satisfactory answer. So let us look at some of these things. Also, the other thing that I observed is when we give up a time domain problem to students on RC circuits or RL circuits, they immediately jump to Laplace transform, okay, and that is actually the last thing one should do, because it is not at all convenient if you are talking about time domain. Laplace transform is okay if you are looking at some periodic kind of input, but it is not okay if you are looking at a general time domain problem. So all these things must be made very clear to the students, and that is why I thought I'll just take up this particular presentation. Okay, so this has to do with RC and RL circuits, and I've said RC and RL circuits with DC sources, but you will see that this is not only with DC sources, but it is also with sources which can change from one value to another. So in strictly, although this is DC sources, it also includes abrupt changes in the DC sources. Okay, so of course the first few slides are just introduction to capacitors and so on. What is a capacitor? No, there are conductors and there is an insulator in between. And although we show this parallel plate structure in class, the actual capacitor construction is anything but this. Right? Normally, what they do is they have these films, and they roll this. They have two films of metal, and they put an insulator in between, they roll this and then they package it. So that is what these capacitors look like. So there is a wide variety of capacitors available. This I have taken from Wikipedia. The important thing is that the capacitance is assumed to be constant, and that is given by epsilon A by thickness, where A is the area of this plate equivalent. In these cases there is no plate, but there is a sort of equivalent area of that plate. T is the thickness. In practice, capacitors are available in a wide range of shapes and values and so on. Okay, I will skip this because this is sort of well known. But one thing that is often not very clear to students is that there are capacitors which are not constant. Okay, and so what we can say in general about a capacitance is that the charge will be like C times V. And so therefore dq by dt is, we say it is C dv dt, but this is only if the capacitance is taken as a constant. If it is not taken as a constant, then the current is not given by C dv dt, but it is given by the more general term dq dt. And why we are pointing this out, that is because in almost all semiconductor devices, for example the PN junction capacitance, it's not a constant capacitance, but it itself depends on what is applied voltage, and therefore in that case C dv dt is not appropriate because C is not constant, right? And even in MOS devices, C is not constant, and then we talk about the charge rather than the capacitance, and the derivative of the charge then gives us the current rather than C dv dt. All right, but in this basic course, we talk about capacitances which are constant, and all of these basically, these are constant capacitances, not voltage dependent. So in that case, the dq dt or the current is simply C dv dt. So that is the sort of starting point of this whole lecture. And the other extremely important point, which students often don't get it, is if V is constant, the current is zero, right? And therefore, the capacitor behaves like an open circuit in DC conditions. Many students have just mucked up this point, like a capacitor is an open circuit in DC. But if you ask them why is that, I mean, they just cannot give a satisfactory explanation. And the explanation is so very simple, right? That the current is C dV dt, the derivative becomes zero, if V is constant, and therefore the current is zero. If the current is zero, the capacitor is an open circuit. It's as simple as that, but students are not even able to tell us this simple reason very often, and that is disturbing. And all this has to do with the way we use our textbooks and the way we design our exams, and just, you know, expect the students to just reproduce certain things where they just mug up. So the whole thing has to change, actually, and that is what this course is all about. All right, go ahead. Plot V, P, and W versus time for the given source current. So this is just to sort of reinforce the students' thinking about the relationship that I is equal to C dV dt. So if I is C dV dt, then V is nothing but 1 over C integral I of t dt, and if I is given, then they simply need to find this integral and then they will get the voltage. So this is just that exercise. Okay, you can go through these plots later, the font is too small for you to read right now, but you can go through these plots and verify that what we have said is right. So an important plot is this power. Okay, so if the voltage is the power is simply given by V times I, and if you do that for this particular case, the power is 0 here, then it rises, then it becomes actually negative, right? And then it becomes finally, when the current becomes 0, the power becomes 0 again at this point. Now, so this, it is very important to point out that the power absorbed by a capacitance can be either positive, as in this region, or it can be negative. What it means is, when the capacitor is absorbing power, that means it is getting charged, right? The current is going into the capacitor, if your polarity is like that. What it means for power to be negative is that the capacitor is actually getting discharged. So all of these things are very important. So in other words, in this region, the capacitor is losing energy. In this region, the capacitor is gaining energy with respect to time. Okay, and this in fact shows the energy as well. So in this, when the power is positive, the energy is actually increasing. When the power is negative, the energy of the capacitor is actually decreasing. So all of this, such a simple figure will actually bring out so many important points. And if the student has just seen this before, his or her understanding can actually improve quite dramatically. Okay, homework. There is some homework that students can do. Inductors. Again, this is all preliminary. Now, inductor is basically a core around which there is a coil, and the magnetic field lines inside the inductor look like that. There is sort of uniform density of the magnetic fields, and then that is a symbol. Again, in this course, we are not so concerned with how a capacitor operates or how an inductance operates, what is flux, what is charge, and so on, but we are more interested in what does it do as a circuit element. And that is all you need really to understand RC circuits, RL circuits. And of course, in addition, if students know a lot about flux and charge and physics, it is even better. But that is not really a prerequisite. An inductor is basically a conducting coil wound around a core. And in fact, it is good to derive this when you are talking about inductors. It is good to give this very simple explanation that the voltage across an inductor is nothing but the number of turns times d phi dt, where phi is the flux that is linked with the inductor. Flux is nothing but B dot A, where A is the area of this coil, and then and so on and so forth. You can relate that with the permeability and the ampere turns, and finally what you get is V equal to L di dt, where L is mu times n squared times area, and mu itself is mu r times mu 0, Now these are interesting formulas, and you can actually bring in some interesting information which will sort of motivate students a little bit to gain further insight. So what do we do if you want to make the inductance large? What we can do is we can make N large, that means increase the number of turns, or we can increase the increase the area, and both of these things will become the make the inductors bulkier or heavier, right? But in addition, you can do you can increase the relative permeability of this material, and that is why we don't use air but we use iron or some other material like that. Otherwise the inductance size will have to be increased hugely to get a given inductance value. All right, so now for a 99.8% pure iron, the permeability, relative permeability is 5000, okay, and that's very large, much larger compared to air, and that is why we have iron cores and not air cores. So therefore an inductance inductor you make with iron will be 5000 times larger than an inductor that you make with air, with other dimensions being the same. There are some other special alloys for which the relative permeability can be as high as 10^6, right? Much larger than even iron. Okay, so all these things are sort of interesting facts and figures which students will find interesting. Okay, so now from the circuit point of view, okay, all we need to know is V is L di dt. That's it, as simple as that. And if I is constant, V is 0, and that is following simply from this equation. If I is constant, the derivative becomes 0, therefore the voltage becomes 0. So an inductor behaves like a short circuit in DC conditions. Now this much people know, but if you ask them why, they cannot relate this fact with this formula, and that is a pity. Okay, that should change. So and this is something that of course we would expect from a highly conducting coil with DC voltage across it. It's just a zero resistance. Okay, this really comes from V equal to L di dt. All right, now finally, before we leave this slide, it is important to point out that this B equal to mu h that we have put over here, okay, is really an approximation. In a normal in many of these materials, B may be a non-linear function of h, and that depends on the core material. But for all our purposes, we will treat this to be valid, and that gives us a constant L, which does not depend on the applied voltage or the current. Okay. So now we come to RC circuits with DC sources, and I want to really start from scratch here, and I would also encourage, or I would urge all the teachers to really start from the basics rather than just stating formulas in class. And so what is the most basic thing that they should know about RC circuits with DC sources? So here is an RC circuit, and I've taken RC circuit with a single C, and that single C has been taken out, right? And the remaining circuit has got resistors, maybe you cannot read, so I'll read it out. Resistors, voltage sources, current sources, and it could have controlled sources like CCVS or CCCS or VCVS and VCCS, you know what that means. So that is a starting point. So the capacitor, there is an RC circuit, the R's could be many, but the C is a single one, right? And that has been taken out here. So the important thing now is to know what this C, what the capacitor will see between A and B. And we all know the answer to that question. And that is, this whole box can be now replaced by an equivalent Thevenin voltage and an equivalent Thevenin resistance. So this whole thing will reduce simply to a Thevenin voltage source and a Thevenin resistance. That's it. So this, no matter how complicated this circuit is, no matter how many connections it has got, as long as it has got only R's and voltage sources and current sources and the dependent sources, this whole black box can be represented by this simple representation, and that is the key to understanding RC circuits without using any Laplace transform kind of mumbo jumbo, right? So let us go ahead. All sources are DC, that is what we are assuming, and therefore VTH is a constant. So this is just a constant number. Why? Because all the independent sources here are assumed to be constant. let's see what happens next because of this fact. Then what happens is we write KVL, which says VTH is equal to RTH times I, the current, times this voltage, the capacitor voltage. And then we replace the current. We know that the current through a capacitor is C dB dt, and therefore we replace this current here by C dB dt, and we get a differential equation VTH equal to RTH times C dB dt plus V. Okay, now this equation has got two solutions. One is a homogeneous solution, one is a particular solution. The homogeneous solution is the solution of this equation dV dt. We can actually divide this whole thing by 1 over RC because that is an important quantity called a time constant. So after we do that, we get dV dt plus 1 over tau V equal to 0. And this 0, of course, this 0 is there because we want to separate the homogeneous and a particular solution. Okay, so homogeneous solution, if I solve this ordinary differential equation, I get the homogeneous solution to be some constant times exponential minus t by tau. Okay. Very simple. Okay. This is something that the students would have already done by the time they come to this class. They would have done mathematics and they would have done differential equations, simple equations like this, and they would know that this is the solution. So there is no black magic there. Next, what is a particular solution? We still need to figure out what is a particular solution to this problem. A particular solution is a specific function that satisfies the differential equation. Okay, and there could be many particular solutions. And how do we get one of these particular solutions? It's very simple. What we do know is that if I just keep this circuit in this configuration, what will eventually happen is that all derivatives will vanish as t goes to infinity, right? That will make the current equal to 0. And so in other words, we will get a steady state, the current will go to 0, all derivatives will go to 0, whether it is a voltage or a current, all derivatives will go to 0, and we get this voltage V, since the current here is 0, the same this voltage will be the same as V Thevenin, and that is our particular solution in this case. So VTH, V equal to VTH is a particular solution which happens to be simply a constant. Okay, so as this is very simple, but it must be emphasized that students must be made aware of the simplicity of this whole thing. Otherwise they just think that this whole thing is all, you know, falling from the heavens, and therefore it has to be mocked up and reproduced in the exams. Okay. So putting all of these things together, we have the total V as the homogeneous solution plus a particular solution, and that is the homogeneous solution is k exponential minus t by tau plus a particular solution which is a constant. In this case, that constant happens to be the Thevenin voltage here. Okay. Next. In general, so now we can actually generalize this, and this happens to be true. V of t is equal to A exponential minus T by 2 tau plus B. In this case, this A is K here and B is VTH here. But in the general case, A and B can be treated as just constants which are to be obtained from known conditions on V. And we will see some examples of doing this. Okay, let's continue. So if all sources are DC, like we have been assuming, we have V of t equal to this expression which we have just seen. The tau here is R times C, where this R is actually the Thevenin resistance as seen from the capacitor. Okay. Now, what is the current through the capacitor? It is C dV dt, and that turns out to be some other constant times exponential minus t by tau. As t tends to infinity, I tends to 0 and the capacitor behaves like an open circuit since all derivatives go to 0. Now, since the current in, so then since the circuit in this black box, in this box is linear, we can say that any variable, any current or any voltage, okay, in this particular circuit can be expressed as a constant k1 exponential minus t by tau plus k2, and that is only because this circuit is linear, okay, where k1 and k2 can be obtained by from suitable conditions on x of t. Okay, Same thing we can do with an inductance, an RL circuit. Again, the inductance has to be a single one, but the resistors can be any number. The voltage sources, current sources, dependent sources can be any number, and all of those things are in this box. So again, we represent this box with its Thevenin representation, and write a KCL, write a KVL, a loop equation, which gives VTH equal to R Thevenin times I plus the voltage across the inductor, that is LdI by dt. And this again is an ordinary differential equation, again with homogeneous equation, homogeneous solution, particular solution, and so on. The only thing that now differs is the time constant. So the time constant is now given by L over RTH, where the RTH is the Thevenin resistance. Particular solution, again the same philosophy. To obtain one particular solution, we can just look at this circuit as t tends to infinity, and as t tends to infinity, all of these derivatives will vanish. LdI dt will become 0, therefore the V will become 0, and therefore the current will become VTH divided by RTH. Okay. So that is a particular solution that we can use. Alright. So again, in the general case, we can write the current, or in fact any quantity in this circuit, any current or any voltage in this circuit, as a constant times exponential minus t by tau plus another constant. Okay, so that is what this slide says, and then let's now take an example, a very simple example. Right? It's a very simple RC circuit with a single source, a single resistance, and a single capacitor. And now we want to explain why this VC cannot change suddenly. Is the sky going to fall down? The answer is no. And but so what will happen if VC actually change suddenly? VC changes suddenly. Let us see. All right. So here is a very simple example showing a step change in VS, and we want to convince ourselves and the students that even if there is a step change here, the capacitor voltage cannot change suddenly. And let us see why. VS changes from 0 at t equal to 0 minus to 5 volts at t equal to 0 plus. As a result of this, VC will rise. Question is, how fast can this VC change? Okay, that is the question. For example, let's just take some concrete numbers to make the discussion a little easier. For example, what would happen if VC changes by 1 volt in 1 microsecond? Okay, suppose this VC changed rather fast, 1 volt in 1 microsecond at a constant rate, as an example, of 1 volt by 1 microsecond. That is, this turns out to be 10^6 volts per second. What will happen if that happens? Okay. What will happen then is the current in the capacitance, current through the capacitance is C dV dt, that is 1 microfarad, the capacitance value, times the rate of change of the current, rate of the change of the voltage, which we have assumed to be 1 volt in 1 microsecond, or 10^6 volts per second. So if I do this simple multiplication, I get 1 microfarad divided by 10^6 volts per second, or 1 ampere. Okay, so that is the current that I will need for a change of that kind, 10^6 volts per second. Is this feasible? Let us see. Now with I equal to 1 ampere and there is a resistance of 1k here, the voltage drop across R would be 1000 volts, right? 1 ampere, 1k, so 1000 volts. And this is not allowed by KVL, because this is only 5 volts. So this, if you have 1000 volts here, KVL in the loop will simply not be satisfied. And that is really the reason why VC cannot change suddenly. Okay. And I have seen that like 90 out of 100 students do not answer this question properly, and that is why it is very important to explain why this is not possible. Textbooks, very many textbooks that are used in engineering colleges, they just say VC cannot change suddenly, and then they just stop at that, and no explanation is given. So that is absolutely the worst thing that one can do to teach students about RC circuits. Okay, so therefore we conclude that VC at 0 plus must be the same as VC 0 minus, and otherwise if it is not the same, then this current will be very large, KVL will be violated, which is not possible. So capacitor does not allow abrupt changes in VC if there is a finite resistance in the circuit. Okay. That is very important. If there is a finite resistance in the circuit, if you have an ideal voltage source and an ideal capacitor, then it is possible for the capacitor voltage to change because it will simply follow this voltage. But there is no such thing as an ideal source, because and even if you didn't connect this resistance externally, a voltage source will always have a small series resistance, whether it is 1 ohm, 10 ohms, 50 ohms or whatever, and therefore this statement will always hold in practice. Similarly, for the same logic, an inductor does not allow an abrupt change in the current, because for an inductor you will have V equal to L di dt, and if your current changed abruptly, di dt will become very large, and at some point the KVL will not allow that. Okay. What do we do in case the source is not a constant but piecewise constant? Okay. Then what happens? Now if I ask this question to a student who is appearing for our MTech interviews, they immediately jump to Laplace transform, and that's absolutely the worst thing that can happen. Okay. But there's no need to really jump to frequency domain when the problem is in time domain, and when you can actually do the problem in time domain, it's even more convenient to do it in time domain. So Laplace transforms are just simply uncalled for and should not be used. Okay, so how do we handle this problem? Although this source is varying with time, it is actually piecewise constant. Okay, so there is a Vs here, is zero here, piecewise constant. So in this region, it's a DC circuit. In this region, it's another DC circuit. In this region, it's a third DC circuit, and so on. Right? So we need to first identify intervals in which the source voltages or currents are constant. For example, here we have just identified these three intervals. Next, for any quantity of interest x of t, we can write general expressions such as x of t equal to a1 exponential minus t by tau plus b1. In this region, we can write a similar expression in this region, right? Only thing is the constants will now change. So instead of a1 and b1, we will have a2 and b2, and so on. Okay, and then we need to use boundary conditions to connect all this. Work out suitable conditions on x of t at specific time points using what facts? Using these facts. If the source voltage or current has not changed for a long time, long compared to tau, then all derivatives are zero. Okay, so that is one thing that we can definitely use. So that means the capacitor current is zero if things are not changed for a long time, and the inductor voltage is zero if things are not changed for a long time. Okay. All right. Then when a source voltage or current changes, say at t equal to t0, the next useful thing that we can use in deriving this constant is Vc of t or IL of t cannot change abruptly, and that we have already explained in the previous slide, very important. So Vc at any t0 plus is the same as Vc at t0 minus. IL at any t0 plus is the same as IL at t0 minus. Okay. These things will help us to go from t1 minus to t1 plus, or t2 minus to t2 plus, and so on. Right. Whenever there are abrupt transitions in the source voltage or source current, then compute a1, b1, etc. using the conditions on x of t. Okay, so let's take this example in some detail and see how we can apply all these things. So you cannot probably see this thing very clearly because of the resolution problem, but go through these slides, find. Okay, everything is self-explanatory. Finally, you end up with this explanation, this expression. Then there is a discharging transient. And so all of this follows very logically from what we have discussed so far, and that is the way it should really be done in class. Okay, rather than just giving this expression out of thin air or this expression for discharging from nowhere, it is always good to derive this systematically, knowing using things that the student has already known at this point. Okay. So this is the same thing, but now it talks about the current, and since the font is very small, we will not go through this. Okay, a very important point here, charging and discharging transients. So here is a charging transient, and what is the duration of this transient? That is an important question, and that must be answered. So this is a charging transient. This is the current. An interesting problem is interesting point to note is that here the current is actually discontinuous. The voltage across the capacitor is continuous because as we have seen, the voltage does not change suddenly, giving rise to violation of KVL, but the current can. So the current does indeed change abruptly here from 0 to 5 milliamp, and then it decays down to 0. Similarly here, the voltage is continuous, but the current is not. Okay. So the, all these plots are actually very useful, helpful in terms of fixing some ideas in the students' minds. Okay. Now, what is the significance of the time constant? It's always good to give a little table like this. This shows x. This shows e raised to minus x. This shows 1 minus e raised to minus x. Okay. And you notice that if x is 5, then e raised to minus x is a very small number. It's like 0.007 or something. And 1 minus e raised to minus x is very close to 1, 0.993. Okay. So that is why we say that normally our x would be t by tau. So when t is 5 times tau, the charging or discharging process is almost complete. And that is why we say that 5 tau is the period of is the time period in which the transient has settled, right? Transient has died down. So this is the figure that shows these numbers in plot form. Okay. So to continue further, so the significance of time constant is shown in this figure. In this case, the time value of resistance is 1k, the capacitance is 1 micro. So therefore, the time constant is 5 milliseconds, and you can see that in about 5, the time constant is 1 millisecond, and in about 5 milliseconds, that is 5 times tau, this transient has become as almost vanished. If I change the resistance to 100 ohms instead of 1k, the transient of course will settle down to its steady state value in a much shorter time. Again, 5 times tau, but now the time has become 10 times less. Same thing for discharging. Okay, now here is an example which illustrates what to do if there is a source which is piecewise constant. Okay, so here we have an inductor, and we are looking at this current, inductor current, and the voltage is given by this figure here. So 0 here, then 10, and then 0 here. Note that these transitions are shown as ideal, sharp, and therefore we have three regions. We have region 1 here in which the source is 0. Region 2 here in which the source is constant, 10 volts, and region 3 here where the source is again 0 volts. Okay. So let us see how we can tackle this kind of problem. So in each of these intervals, our differential equation, the nature of the differential equation actually is not going to change, and therefore the same expression A times e raised to minus t by tau plus B is going to be valid in all of these regions. Only the constants will change. So how do we start attacking this problem? You first of all, we need to look at this circuit as the inductor will see it. Okay, so let's take the inductor out, redraw the circuit, and then replace it by its Thevenin equivalent. Okay, so that is what is shown over here. So the Thevenin equivalent turns out to be 8 ohms here. You can go through all these numbers, that's not very important. The time constant turns out to be 0.1 second. Okay. All right. So now, so up to this point, things are steady, and we say that this inductor current is, the inductor voltage is 0, and therefore we can actually calculate the current, knowing R1, R2, everything actually will be 0 up to T0. Beyond T0, we enter a region where the voltage has now changed to 10 volts, and now this is the key, right? How do we evaluate these constants now, A and B? For that, what we need to do is, we already have one condition at this point, and that condition is that the inductor current which was whatever value at 0 minus must now be the same at 0 plus. That is one condition. The second condition comes from this fact. Okay. So now we are in this state. Now the circuit actually does not know whether this voltage is going down to 0 or is it going to stay at this value infinitely. Right. So suppose we assume that this voltage is going to actually stay there indefinitely. Now we can figure out what will happen if t went to infinity and the voltage remained at 10 volts. So that gives us some of the constants. Okay, and that is all that is shown in this slide. All right. Now in reality, of course, what happens is this voltage will go down to 0, and so we need to worry about what happens here at this point. So go through. So the third phase, in the third phase of the transient, we get this particular result. And finally, what we do is we put together all of these, this and this and this, and then get the final transient. Okay, which looks like this. Okay, so that's one example of how to handle RC circuits or RL circuits with piecewise constant sources. Okay. Now another commonly encountered problem is if there is a switch in the circuit which is opening at some specific time, and then what happens to the various quantities in the circuit. So how do we tackle this kind of problem? Okay. So here first of all let's figure out regions in time or the intervals in time for which the circuit can be represented by a circuit in which we have a capacitor, resistors and DC sources. In this particular case, there are two distinct time intervals, t less than 0 in which the switch is closed giving us this circuit, and t greater than 0 in which the switch is open and giving us this circuit. Okay. All right. So that is, so there is one problem for t less than 0 and another problem for t greater than 0. Both of these problems, we have a single capacitor and we have a circuit in which there are resistors and voltage sources, current sources, control sources. In this case, particular case, there is only a voltage source. Here again, we have a circuit in which there is a capacitor and there is a circuit in which there are resistors, sources and control sources. And in this particular case, all the voltage sources and current sources are 0. Okay. But these are just special cases of the very first slide that we saw, in which we showed a black box with DC sources, resistors and so on. Okay. And therefore, our expression, namely A exponential minus T by tau plus B, will apply in both of these cases. So where do we begin? We begin at T equal to 0. We will assume that the circuit has been in this state for a long time. What does that mean? That means this capacitor current is 0 because the circuit is in steady state. Once that is known, we know that this is an open circuit, we can actually find this current I that turns out to be 1 milliamp and so on. Okay. So once we have the situation at t equal to 0 minus, we use the continuity of the capacitor voltage to connect with this figure. So the capacitor actually provides us the connection between 0 minus and 0 plus. So Vc, we can calculate Vc at 0 minus, that turns out to be 5 volts. So therefore, we can say that Vc at 0 plus, which is this situation here, is also 5 volts, and that is really the connection between t less than 0 and t greater than 0 circuits. Okay. So the rest of the slide is just more details, and you should actually go through this and convince yourself that you will get this kind of expression or this kind of plot for the current. Note that the current is discontinuous, this particular current. So it is, there is a discontinuity here, whereas the capacitor voltage will be continuous. That is the capacitor voltage. So the capacitor voltage is actually continuous, but other quantities in the circuit need not be, right? And that is what we have just shown over here. Okay. So make sure you actually can justify all of these plots based on the expressions. There is a simulation file called E101RC2 that you can use as well. There is some homework. All right, so this is something that is that you can give students as a homework, and then if you don't want them to submit the homework, they can, you can say that okay, you can try out this simulation and see if your results are actually correct or not. Another homework. More homework. Okay, so yeah, so I think that is all that we have for this RC and RL circuits in piecewise constant or constant sources. Okay, so I wanted to cover this because I see many misconceptions in this topic, and this is a topic that we are not going to cover in any other lectures next week. So I thought it is important to just go through this. Let me see if there is something else I would like to cover in the time that is remaining. Okay, there are topics which we are going to be covered in the next week, so I don't want to take that up. But let's look at some RLC circuits, and I'm doing this because I want to also show you an applet which will be useful in understanding RLC circuits and resonance and quality and bandwidth and that kind of stuff. Okay, so I thought I'll just talk a little bit about RLC circuits, and then we will look at one Java applet that can help you to illustrate some of these things in class. Okay, all of these things, of course, you know, the current phasor is given by Vm by the total impedance in the circuit and so on. Okay, and all of this is all standard expressions, the magnitude of the current and the angle of the current. Okay, here is an example of what that looks like, the resonance. So here we are plotting Im, the magnitude, versus frequency. And whenever you are talking about frequency, it's always good to plot it on log scale. Otherwise, you won't get good resolution, like we were saying yesterday. And that is the phase. Okay, and then there are these definitions of the bandwidth and so on. There was one question about why this bandwidth is defined as I max by square root 2. And the reason for that, of course, is like we were talking about when we were discussing Bode plot. We said that power, normally we talk about dB as a power ratio, right? But if it is a voltage or current ratio, then since power goes as voltage squared or current squared, we talk about ratio of squares, and that is where that root 2 comes. So if the power becomes half, that means the current has become 1 over square root 2 times. Okay, so the important result that I wanted to point out is this bandwidth is R over L, irrespective of C, so it does not depend on C in this case. Quality is omega naught divided by bandwidth, so it is given by omega naught L by R. Okay. Now this is a very important point, and that is something that students often don't realize. Show that at resonance, the magnitude of VL and magnitude of VC are both equal to quality times VM, where VM is the maximum, VM is the peak of this input voltage. Okay. So what it means is that actually all the inductor and capacitor voltages at resonance can be actually quite large, very large. Right, because the quality can be like 10 or 20 or even some circuits even be larger than that, and that is a very important point. Show that omega 0 is square root omega 1 omega 2. All these things are interesting exercises to give students. Okay, what happens if R is increased? If R is increased, then the current will, the peak current will decrease. Also, it will change the shape of the resonance, the curve. Okay, one important point: for omega less than omega 0, the net impedance is capacitive and the current leads the applied voltage. That is a very important conclusion. for omega equal to omega 0, the net impedance is purely resistive and the current is in phase with the applied voltage. And for omega greater than omega 0, the net impedance is inductive and the current lags the applied voltage. So all of these things are actually very important to point out to students so that they can understand this topic better. Okay, here is a time domain example. So here what we have three frequencies. This is the center one is at resonance. Center one is at resonance. This is before resonance and this is after resonance. And then you can show the current leading the voltage or lagging the voltage in these plots. Okay, here is a phasor diagram. So this is at resonance. So Vs and Vr are actually the same. And notice that VL and VC here are actually large, but they are opposite each other and therefore they cancel each other exactly. And in these two figures, this is before resonance and this is after resonance. Okay, so this is it's very important to discuss these phasor diagrams, and this phasor diagram is what I wanted to talk about when I show the applet. Okay, so let me just do that part and something that you can use in class. Share the desktop, okay. Minimize. Alright, so let me look at this RLC circuit. Yeah, alright. So what this applet does is it allows you to choose R and L and C, and you can compute the response. It will compute the resonance frequency, it will compute the quality, and it will compute the maximum value of the current. Okay, and all of that will be plotted here. Okay, and when you start the animation, this scale is not too, the resolution is probably a little too large, the size is a little too large, but anyway, let's see. When you start the animation, okay, you get these plots here, and let me just pause and show how we can use this in class. Alright, so here we have four different quantities. One is the inductor voltage, that is the inductor voltage, capacitor voltage, the green one, and the resistance, the voltage across the resistor. Now the voltage across the resistor and the current through the circuit basically are in phase, so therefore the inductance voltage is leading the resistance voltage and the capacitor voltage is lagging the resistor voltage. This blue line is VL plus VC, and that is what is shown over here. And it turns out that this particular phasor VR actually traces a circle, right? Because this angle between VL plus VC and this voltage is always 90 degrees, and therefore it traces a circle. Okay, so you see that as we approach resonance, these magnitudes actually start growing, and at resonance they can be quite large. It depends on the quality of the circuit. And VR, the resistor voltage, at resonance it is actually equal to this source voltage, and away from resonance it is smaller, but it always falls on this circle, and that is because that angle is always 90 degrees. Okay, so that is the animation that I wanted to show you, and you can use this in class. If I change this, you can play with these values, and even the formula is actually displayed on this same applet, so the students can actually connect all these calculations with these formulas here as the animation is going on. Okay. Alright, so I think we have reached the end of this session, and it is also my last lecture, and let's go through some question and answer session. If you have any questions, go ahead and ask. KJ Somaya College, your question.
Hello sir, in case of RS flip-flop, when you are feeding R equal to 1 and S equal to 1, it is written that in truth table it is not allowed. Not allowed in what sense? If I tried physically giving R and S, it is harmful to the circuit, or?
Okay, the answer has to do with, like when we were talking about the RS latch, right? the first latch that we took, the NAND gate, in that R equal to 0, S equal to 0 was not allowed. In the second latch that we took, the NOR latch, R equal to 1, S equal to 1 was not allowed. And later on we saw one reason why that is so. So briefly the answer is, suppose you allow that condition, for example take a NOR latch, let me just write this on paper. Okay, so suppose I make this equal to 1 and this also equal to 1. So what will happen, because it's a NOR gate, this will become 0 and this will become 0. Okay, all right, and we say that this is not allowed. So let us see why it is not allowed. So let us draw this plot. Okay, let me just sketch it here. So let's say R has been 1, S has been 1 up to here, and then Q has been 0 and Q bar is also 0, right. Now suppose this becomes 0, okay. Now the question is, what happens to Q or Q bar, right. Now if R and S are 0, our table says that the state, the Q is the previous state, okay. Now in this case, what is the previous state? There is no such thing as previous state because our Q is 0, Q bar is also 0, and what the circuit will settle down to is not very clear. We might have Q equal to 1 or we might have Q equal to 0. All that will depend on what are the delays of these two gates. So that is, and so there is an uncertainty when we are going from 1 1 to 0 0, and that is the uncertainty that we don't like, right. So that is why R equal to 1, X, S equal to 1 is not allowed. Okay, any other questions?
Sir, in case of capacitor, we are having the insulator between the two plates of the capacitor, so of course the conventional current will not flow through the capacitor, but it is given that the displacement current will flow through the capacitor. So please sir, don't give answer orally, draw some schematic and tell me how exactly the charges will move from one plate to another plate, so that you can say that some displacement current will flow over.
So the question is about displacement current in a capacitor. So let's take a capacitor. So let's say the voltage at a particular point time is positive V, right, and so there is some charge here and there is a negative charge here, okay. Now let's say with time there is a positive current flowing inside from this terminal to that terminal. So what is actually happening in this capacitor, right, because there is, these charges really cannot go through this material because that's dielectric and that's insulating. So what is actually happening? So what actually happens is, as time goes by, this charge will increase, this charge will also increase, okay. And how, what makes it possible to have this change? All that is happening because because of the flow of current in the external circuit, not internal circuit, right. And I cannot do that right now, but if you write Maxwell's equation, you can actually show that this current will be the same as the term dd dt in this in the parallel plate, okay. And so inside the plate the current is not a physical current, but it is just the displacement current, which is exactly the same as the external current. So that is what happens in a capacitor. Shirpur, you have your question?
Sir, my question is related to the initial current. condition, when you are, hello, when you are, and we can find out the initial condition, whenever we can connect the DC source across any RLC circuit, and that time we can find out any current or any voltage across the capacitor, we have to find out. So that time we can, there is any need to find out the initial condition at every time?
I did not get the question fully, but from what I understand, the question is if you have an RLC circuit with DC sources. Is it necessary to find the initial condition every time? Okay, that is what I understand as the question. So the answer is, let's just take a simple example. Let's say you have something like this, LC, R1, R2 and so on. And let's say this voltage is like this. Okay, so there are regions in which the voltage is constant. Another region here where the voltage is constant, and a third region here where the voltage is constant. Now, when you come to 0 minus, let's call this 0. When you come to 0 minus, you know that this current has been 0, would have been 0 because this situation is there for a long time, and things have reached steady state, derivatives are 0, therefore this voltage is 0 across this inductance, and we also know that this current is 0 through the capacitor. Right? This will allow you to calculate IL at 0 plus and VC at 0 plus, which are actually the same as IL at 0 minus and VC at 0 minus. Alright, so now we have another source in the circuit, right? So using this value, you find your IL or VC of T. Okay, and what do you do in this case? You assume that this voltage source actually is going to continue all the way up to infinity. And use those conditions to find all the constants that you need. Now when you come to this point, right, you need to go from, let's call this T0, you need to go from T0 minus to T0 plus. At this point again, you need to calculate IL at T0 minus using the expression you found, VC at T0 minus using again the expression that you found for V0, VC of T. And then this is the same as IL at T0 plus, and this is the same as VL at T0 plus. Okay, so the inductor current, the capacitor voltage will provide you the continuity between transitions, and that is how it has to be used. So in that sense, the initial conditions must be calculated every time.
Sir, one more question is. Hello, one more question is related to the at the time of K-map. Whenever we can design the K-map, that time there is any, if you can change the order of the column, means just like whenever we can design the K-map, the order is 00, 01, 11 and 10. So can you change the order of that column instead of 11, we can change the 10 for 4 variable?
Okay, the question is about K-maps. Is the speaker on? The question is about K-maps, and we actually had answered this question in the lecture, but let me just take it again. Let's say you have 4 variables, A, B, C and D. Normally what we do is we label these columns so that there is only one change of variable allowed from column to column or row to row, right? That is how we actually do these things. Okay. So let me take an example. Sorry, this is 10. So let me take an example of a term like, let's say what term called X equal to, let's say B. Okay. So what will this look like in this map? X is equal to B, so it will look like, or let me take X equal to B, C bar for example. Okay. So that will look like B is 1, right? So B is 1, C is 0. So that will look like 1 here, 1 here, 1 here, 1 here. Okay. And then therefore, if I am given this pattern, I know I can combine these two, and I can derive this term from those two, those four ones. All right. So now suppose I did not order it, did not order these columns like that, but like you are saying, I order the columns like this. Okay, let us see what happens now to a term like this. Okay, B C bar, so B is 1, C is 0. So 1 here, 1 here, B is 1, so 1 here and 1 here, right. So now you see that although this they are supposed to be adjacent, like in this one. In this map, they don't appear as adjacent. I cannot combine these. I don't know whether these should be combined or not. Whereas if I order it like this, I know that they are adjacent. They form a rectangle of size 2 raised to n, where n is 2 in this case, and therefore I can combine them. So that is the reason we have to label the columns so that there is only one change between any two columns. We will go to another center now. Periyar Vellore. What is your question?
Hello, good afternoon, sir. So my question is, given a resistor, capacitor, and a DC source, constant DC source, how do you measure or how do you find the time constant of the RC circuit practically? My next question is, how to model a Norton's current source or how to prove a Norton's theorem practically? What's the correct procedure to prove the Norton's theorem practically, sir? Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Okay, first question is if there is an RC circuit, how do you find the time constant in practice? Okay, so let's take some example. We will only take a circuit in which there is a single capacitor. Okay, so let's say there is a circuit like this and there is a voltage source. Okay, there are some capacitors, resistors R1, R2, R3. Now let's say we apply a VS of this kind and measure any of these quantities, for example this VC or I measure this VR2 or whatever, right. So any measure, any current or any voltage will do something like this, either like that or like that or whatever, where from this I can extract the time constant, okay, from the shape of this. I can see how fast this is rising. I can actually just compare this with the exponential minus t by tau and find out from there what should tau be, so that this expression matches this one. But now in practice, if you apply this, you cannot see this on an oscilloscope. Okay. So what you do is you apply a signal like this. Make sure that the time constant, the frequency of the period of the signal is much larger than the time constant. And now you can see this waveform or something like this on the oscilloscope. So now you will be able to see this trace on the oscilloscope, and now you can concentrate on this part and get your time constant. Okay, so that is what you will do in practice. The second question I don't quite understand fully. It has to do with Norton theorem. How do you prove Norton's theorem, right? So for that matter, how do you prove Thevenin's? Okay, so how do you prove Norton theorem, or for that matter, how do you prove Thevenin's theorem? Now, proof of these would be given in any network theory book, and I know at least one of these books, which is called Bala Bunyan. I'm not sure about the spelling, but it's something like that. Right? but if you take one of these classic network theory books, you will find a proof in that. It's not something that I can do right now. And between Thevenin and Norton, the transformation actually is very easy to see. This is your Thevenin equivalent circuit. This is your Norton equivalent circuit. And let's say it's the same circuit that we are looking at. Now suppose I'll measure this open circuit voltage. In this case I'm going to get an open circuit voltage equal to VTH because the current is 0. In this case I'm going to get an open circuit voltage which is IN multiplied by RN. Okay. Now let's say I short these. What is the short circuit current that is going to flow? It is going to be ISC is equal to VTH by RTH. Suppose I short these two here. What is the current that is going to flow? This is zero resistance, so all of this current will actually go through this short circuit. There is no voltage drop here. So ISC is equal to IN. Okay. So from these two, I will get RN equal to RTH and IN equal to VTH by RTH. Okay. So that is how, that is the conversion between Thevenin and Norton. Okay, we'll go to another center, Mufakam College.
My question is, what are the differences between a latch and a flip-flop, sir? Over to you.
What is the difference between a latch and a flip-flop? Okay, so they are actually very similar. Latch is, if there is a clock in a latch, it is level sensitive. That means clock equal to 1 will make things happen. Whereas in a flip flop, clock is equal to 1 is not enough, as we have seen. But there has to be an edge in the clock. The active edge could be either a positive edge or a negative edge. So that is the basic difference between latch and a flip flop.
Yeah, my next question is, among NAND and NOR, which gate is preferable in the formation of a flip flop? Over to you, sir.
Okay, the question is, among NAND and NOR, which gate should we prefer for a flip flop? This is a very technology dependent question. In some technologies, maybe it's easier to make a NOR gate. In some other technologies, it's easier to make a NAND gate. So it really depends on which technology you're using. Also, it will depend on whether you are using static gates or dynamic gates and so on. So it's not an easy question to answer. You can just post it on Moodle. Maybe Professor Sharma can explain if there is a single answer.
My next question is, sir, what is the importance of preset and clear in a flip flop, sir?
Okay. The question is, what is the importance of preset and clear in a flip-flop? So as we said, these inputs actually can be used to design counters, and in fact we have seen a counter in which we let the counter count up to a certain state and we made sure that the next state will reset all the flip-flops. So that is just one application. But there are other things, like for example, when you start up a digital circuit, you don't know what state each flip-flop is going to enter into, right? And that will decide its subsequent behavior. Now, if we would like each flip-flop to wake up in a known state, and that is where preset and clear inputs can be used, because they will force the flip-flop to be either 0 or 1 depending on what preset and clear are, and that is irrespective of the clock input. We'll go to Truba College.
Hello. Op-amp is formed by connecting two diodes, two transistors in parallel. Why? Op-amp is formed by connecting two transistors in parallel. Why one cannot make op-amp by connecting two transistors in series?
Okay, the question is why op-amp is formed by connecting two transistors in parallel and not in series. Okay, the answer has to do with the basic differential pair. And that is like this. I'm just drawing the BJT part. You can have similar things in MOS as well. All right. So the way this circuit works is that this voltage, if V1 is greater than V2, then this current I1 is greater than I2. V1 is less than V2, then I1 is less than V2, I2, such that I1 plus I2 is 50. Okay, that is the basic principle of a differential amplifier. And then once you have I1 and I2 change, then you can take this to an appropriate stage, the next stage, and enhance the difference between these two. Now you cannot do the same thing if you connect these two resistors and the two transistors in parallel. So that is answer.
Capacitance, an inductor and capacitor are considered as linear component or non-linear? At what condition they will be considered as linear?
Okay, the question is whether capacitance and inductance is linear under what conditions. So as we have seen, for a capacitor, the current here is actually given by I equal to dq dt. Now, if this, it all, so whether the capacitor is linear or not linear will depend on whether this Q is a linear function of the voltage or not. So if Q is simply CV divided by, so d dt of CV, where C is a constant, then this is a linear element, because then the C comes out. If Q is non-linear, is a different function, for example, if Q is square root of V, okay, then your derivative of the current will itself become 1 over 2 square root V, right. Now this is not a dvdt, so this would be considered a non-linear capacitor. Same thing holds with an inductor. If the flux is a linear function of the current, then it's a linear conductor, otherwise it's a non-linear conductor. Yeah, we can go to another center. KJ Somaya College, you have a question?
Sir, in case of capacitor, the energy stored is 1 half CV square. Definitely that energy will get stored in the dielectric medium between the two plates. So exactly in which form? Definitely we'll answer that the electrostatic field get created over there. In that energy gets stored. But I don't want that answer. I read in one book the dipole formation takes place inside the dielectric medium. So can you explain in that context?
So the question is, how is energy stored in a capacitor, in what form? So when we say C, energy is equal to half CV squared, what exactly is this? Right. And so it's really a sort of physics question more than engineering, but let's see if we can. So in a capacitor, a simple parallel plate capacitor, we have these kind of charges. Okay, now let's just take a hypothetical condition where we have a plus Q charge here, right, and we are bringing in a minus Q charge from infinity to some place close to this, right. So now definitely we need to do some work to make this happen, and that work is equivalent to the energy that is stored in this capacitor. Okay, so that is what it is. That is probably the best answer I can give you right now.
Sir, but the dipole formation takes place over there?
Dipole formation, whether the dipole formation takes place over there. Well, a dielectric will have dipoles, but I am not sure if you change the charge on the parallel plate capacitors, if the dipole moment will change and so on. So I must pass this question. I will refer you to this book by Resnick and Halliday, and they talk about electrostatics in detail. So it is called Physics Part 2 by Resnick and Halliday. So just look up this book, you might find the answer to that question over there. Jay Cham Rajendra College, what is the question?
My question to you is, can you explain the working of a dual emitter transistor in a circuit and its significance over sir?
Okay, the question is about dual emitter transistor. And its significance. This really has to do with bipolar technology more than anything else. So the way transistors are made is there is a collector, let's say an NPN transistor, with the collector will be N-type. Then there is a base, there is a base contact here, P plus, and then there is the emitter. Okay, so that is the normal transistor configuration. Now if you want to have two emitters, then it's very easy to do, because you can just introduce one more of these N plus regions. So this is your one emitter, this is the other emitter. Okay. And since the base and the collector region are common, that is that will this single device with a little additional area will actually serve as two transistors. And this is better than making two separate transistors, one like this and one more like that, okay, in terms of area. So that is why this configuration is sort of favored. The other thing is, then you are absolutely sure that these two emitters will see the same conditions like temperature and so on. So that's the other reason. Okay, sorry we could not take all the questions, but please do post them on Moodle and we will get back to you. So we'll break for lunch now. Thanks.